Hey guys, this is Declan from DJ Mag. Welcome to today's live stream. We've got a very special guest of Ferry Corsten. He's going to join us in just a second to show us how he makes trance melodies in Silent and Cubase. And he's going to make a little idea for us, give you guys an insight into how he makes tracks from scratch. And then we're going to give you guys a little competition at the end, but I'll let him explain that. Let's bring him into the conversation, shall we? Okay. Here he comes, connected to audio. Hey man, how you doing?
Good, man. How are you?
Good to see you.
And you?
How are things in Rotterdam? That's where you're based, right?
Rotterdam, yeah.
How are things in lockdown there?
Well, it's the same as everywhere, man. I mean, I think in Holland, we're still pretty lucky to have a very relaxed sort of approach to the whole thing. You know, we're still allowed to go out walking, provided there's social distancing, of course. And no groups together more than so many. So it's all pretty limited, but we can still go out and happy days. So you can get some fresh air.
yeah, that's key, isn't it? I mean, especially if you're trying to stay creative. I mean, have you managed to kind of keep the creative juices flowing in this period?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I have so much time in the studio now. Normally, there's always like, you got to divide your time in the week, you know, between studio stuff and packing your bags and travel again in the weekends. So it's actually really nice to sort of like have a steady stay at home again, you know, and be with the family. And when I feel like it at night, I just dive into the studio. Great. So it's a very different sort of creative flow than usually, because there's no pressure. It's just like, okay, you know, whenever you feel like it. And instead of like, oh yeah, you got 4 days to sit and finish stuff. So before the traveling starts again. So yeah, it's great.
Yeah. We've been speaking to a few artists and they've kind of said the same thing about getting off the circuit in a way, getting off the touring circuit and getting back in the studio and not having that pressure of like, because sometimes having limitations can be good for creativity. You know,
absolutely.
You've always got a deadline, but now it's like, it's kind of open-ended. Have you found that that's been better for you?
Yeah, I mean, a deadline is always, you know, when you're traveling and constantly providing your set with yourself for your set with tracks, right, that you basically make for your set, it's really nice to be in another sort of frame of mind, you know, where there is no set, at least not anytime soon. And you know, for the occasional live stream thing, you know, you don't have to build like complete new sort of set all the time or new tracks all the time. So it's that pressure gone also gives you room to just dive in a bit more and experiment a bit more and just do some other stuff that normally you think like, you know, I don't have the time for this because I need to finish this track for my set, which is great. Yeah.
So we're going to see an ambient album from Ferry Corsten then?
Well, I just released one. So
Yeah.
So I mean,
in a part two.
Maybe part two. Yeah.
Perfect timing. But,
in that sense, it gives a lot of extra sort of room to maneuver without having to do the same thing, you know, all the time.
Yeah. Sure.
So you know, I'm really curious to see what comes out of it. Not for myself, but from basically everyone, you know, who has a lot of time in the studio right now and has the luxury to explore and just widen their horizon, and in a way going back to where a lot of the longtime producer DJs came from, you know, instead of just having that fixation on, oh, this is the music for my main stage set next weekend. You
know? Yeah.
And, which is really, really interesting to see what will come out of this.
Yeah. And we were just talking before we went on air, I mean, about doing this type of collaboration, sharing screens remotely, and everyone's going to be working remotely now anyway. I mean, a lot of DJs, when they collaborated with people across the world, they worked remotely anyway. So they were using things like Skype and Zoom and sharing screens. I mean, is that something you're going to have to get used to now? I mean, was that something you did before?
Well, I definitely did a lot of, for the collaborations, was always a lot of sharing, but mostly file sharing, you know? So I would get MIDI files and we'd get audio that would come with it. And I would just go from there, send my sort of like next stage in the process of the track back to the guy I'm working with. and so forth, you know, back and forth. And every once in a while there would be a Skype session, you know, but mostly it's just really receiving files and sharing them in a Dropbox folder and dump stuff in and whatever. But yeah, I mean, it definitely is a whole different way of being creative, you know, when you just get files from someone, you know, and you in a way, you know their intention with the files, where they want to go. But they also leave room for you to take it to the next step. And so they can bounce off your ideas again. And, you know, and that's the beauty of working remotely almost, you know, when you're together in a studio, it's like, oh yeah, step on the brake, you know, now we got to go there. And almost you find yourself sometimes in situations where you don't get the opportunity to really go all the way where you want to go because the other guy is there, like, and he stops you, slows you down already. And with this, when you get files and, you know, the other party basically is waiting for your input to go off on again, it gives you a bit more, space and a bit more, a bigger way to just say, okay, this is where I see this go. Yeah. So, but it's interesting. Always cool to do that.
It's going to be a lot of collaboration happening remotely now anyway, so.
For sure.
We have to get used to, I guess. I mean, we've already got questions coming in, so let me just remind everyone we are live. So do get your questions in the comments on Twitch, Facebook, or YouTube, or wherever you are watching us. So Ferry, today we're going to take a look at basically making trance melodies, right?
Yeah, I mean, you know, making a trance melody is you know, in the end it's a melody.
Yeah,
you know, a melody that could also be a house, hard style, drum and bass, whatever melody. It's just really the way you pack it in, you know what I mean? So it's your choice of sounds or whatever. You know, are you making it lush with reverbs and delays? It's instantly more trancey than when you keep it completely dry. So those are little things that differentiated a trance melody from any other melody, really.
Yeah, I mean, is melody, obviously melody is a big part of your sound, but is melody, would you always start with melody? Would you start with drums sometimes and work around the bass lines, or do you always go straight in with chords and melody lines?
Mostly I'm looking for a melody, because in trance it's really melody, it definitely is the hook of the track. It's definitely one of the genres that is really based around melody. So whereas certain more percussive genres, you know, melody doesn't really matter so much. It's just all about the groove, and trance is really about the melody because in melody that's where the emotion is. And a trance track gets its face from the melody and the vibe it has, really, you know. And so that's why I'm always looking for a melody first, and then the chords, or first a chord, and out of the chords I create a melody, and then the track builds itself around it, really. Mm-hmm. How do I want to go about it? Is it going to be a more aggressive track, a slower track, a sweeter track? Then the choice of sounds for your bass lines and for your and the programming of your bass lines and the punch of your kick drum, you know, all start adding up into what this track is going to be eventually. Yeah. So yeah.
So even when you have when you're trying to decide on your bass line sound or your drum samples, they all feed off the original melodies.
Yeah, I mean, it's sort of like it goes hand in hand, really. Because I've had many times where I felt like, okay, I'm just gonna make a banger of a track, and it turns out to be a really softy, sort of like a beautiful atmospheric thing, you know. So it never is. It's not set in stone, really. But yeah, everything depends on each other, really. Yeah. Yeah.
So with that in mind, shall we dive into Cubase and take a look? Do you want to share your screen with us?
Yeah. Let's see. So obviously. I'm working on Cubase. Wait, hang on a minute. Let me do that again, because I don't think I have the sound. There we go. So this is what I had for now. I just want to test for you, Declan, if you got the sound coming in here, though. Got that? Good. Okay. So As you can see here, oh, this is some audio. Let's put that here. As you can see, this is for what we are going to talk about a little later. This is what I've done so far. It's a chord progression. If we dive in here, you see what I have. And that would be this. And that's my filter closing again, right there. So very uplifting, very happy. Then usually from there, I'll try to come up with a melody that takes it sort of like to that sing-along factor. You cannot sing, you can't really sing to chords. If you sing to a chord, you basically almost sing the top note, right? Like this one. If you would sing with the chords, but that's not really a melody. So to give the track its real sort of identity, you know, you need a top line melody, which is this one in my case. So basically, it's just chords, and there's the melody, and it already sounds like a big trance break, you know? And within the chords, there's pretty much your bass line already that you should follow, you know? So it's really easy to fill in these notes with like a bass line groove, if you will. And you can go all the way like in 16, rolling. Or like the eights, or you make it a bit more groovy where there's a bit more space between the bass notes and all of a sudden you feel a bit more like dancing. So there's pretty much a trance break already. And yeah, if I want to go to like old school trance, you know, I usually take my chords and go crazy on the arpeggiating stuff, you know, and I never use an arpeggiator. I always program it because then you have control over what's going on. So in this case, I just, you know, just to keep it simple, I work a lot with silent, just also to use it as a sketch, basically, just to draft up some sounds that are sort of like in the ballpark of where I want to go with the final stuff. You know, it's easy as the filtering and stuff. It's all very straightforward with this one. So, but I'll tell you what I mean when following the chords and the actual arpeggiator sort of riff sound. So in a nutshell, that's what I've done for this quick session.
Yeah. I mean, it kind of like it teases of what's to come, like every great breakdown.
Yeah, would you, because you can already almost anticipate that from here, you almost want to... See you then. 1, 2, 3, bang, drop, you know? So you already can feel what's coming. So in a nutshell, without all the elements of drums and bass line and effects and stuff, there is the core essence of a trance track already.
Yeah. And would you recommend using silent if you were just starting out? Is that a good place to begin?
If you want to go for the typical soul synth type of trance stuff and you don't have a ton of hardware, luckily I've all this stuff behind me that, you know, that I used to play with over the years and still do. You know, Silent, for example, is really easy. It's really good. It has that typical sound, but there are so many good, amazing soft synths that, that have the same sort of characteristics, right? I mean, I just use a Silence right here, just for an example. But, you know, we can go with anything. I mean, this one is a really cool little synth, which is the Pigments from Arturia. That's the main,
that's a great one.
It's the main melody. Great sound. I still, for a lot of basic stuff, real basic stuff, I actually do use Nexus a lot. Of course, I can hear many people go like, why do you use Nexus? But just before what I said, it's basic. And, you know, it's, I use this a lot for pads, for bass sounds, you know. And if I wanna spice it up, I'll run it through a rack of crazy effects and distortions and weird stuff to take it away from the typical Nexus sound. But it's easy. It's, you know, you have the I don't see the need to just dive in to a synth for hours at a time to find a sound that is very close, that something very close to that is already in one of the other plugins, right? So I'd rather look for something that's really close to what I'm looking for, and then I start to shape it in what I want it to be.
If you've got a deadline and you're hit on a Thursday, you got to get from A to B as quickly as possible.
Absolutely. And to be honest, you know, there's nothing that an amazing, beautiful delay and reverb, lush reverb, can't fix, you know?
The old saying.
You know, yeah. So a little splash and yeah.
Yeah, I mean, just some more questions for me before we go into questions from the audience, of which there are many already, which is great. Keep them coming.
Awesome.
You mentioned about having chords and then taking the bass line from like maybe the root note. Is that something you suggest for someone who's just starting out and maybe doesn't know that much about music theory?
Yeah, that is, because the bass notes of the chords are pretty much what the chords are built on, right? So it's easiest if you're a little confused of like, okay, where should I go with this? Then that's the easiest approach to do something that is still musically correct, basically. And the chords write the bass line for you already.
Yep, exactly. Right, so speaking of melodies, Shane Fagan is asking, how often do melodies come to you, example, lying in bed, and do you need to capture them ASAP? Do you like have your phone app always ready to go?
Oh, I do sometimes. Yeah, crazy situations sometimes. Melodies can come from everywhere, right? It doesn't always have to be when I'm in my little lonely spot and like, oh, I'm drafting up a melody in my head. That could be good example. I'm snowboarding in Austria and I'm going down a mountain and I'm passing one of those mountain restaurants that have music playing outside, and it's one of those little Tyrolean music thingies, right? As I pass it, the sound coming from the restaurant does something else to my head and to my ears than what is actually playing. So I hear a melody based on what I just heard, stopping right middle of the slopes, get my phone out, my memory recorder, and sing what I sing. And in my head, I have the bass line that goes with it, because I have to sing that too. Otherwise, I forget what the melody did in context, right? So the craziest things happen sometimes, you know, and that's the beauty of it.
Yeah, I guess those melodies that come outside the studio can be more natural than when you're sitting looking at the grid and everything's quantized and everything's MIDI notes.
Absolutely. Yeah. And from the funniest sort of sources, you know, often. So it's just really an interesting process sometimes. I'm sometimes really amazed, like, wow, you know. And also, very often the melody builds itself while you're working on let's say a very basic melody, and you put chords there, you're like, it's really basic melody, and you start, while listening to it over and over again, some of the harmonies that are in those synth notes, you know, the harmonics start to play inside your head, and you start hearing these other notes that are actually not really there, but you just start hearing them, and based on that, sometimes you can just build an amazing sort of like, you know, a bit more complex melody as well. Yeah,
absolutely. I mean, Chad's asking something kind of related to this. Chad Sharnak, which is worth dedicating more of your time to, learning how to master and produce, or learning and practicing with your instrument or your hardware?
It's really good. I mean, I watched mastering and producing. I think those are two different things, really. Mastering and mixing and producing, you know. Of course, I know that I ideally want to practice a lot more playing keys. I mean, I can play, I can, you know, but it's far from being an absolute skilled piano player, you know. I know what I want to find, and I can't find it, but don't ask me to just play it right there on the spot. I don't work that way. I'm not good enough in that sense as a real player. So that would be one thing. I would love to spend more time on it, and seeing the situation we're in right now, I think, you know, this I may come out of this as a skilled piano player, I don't know. But other than that, mixing and or producing, you know, arranging and stuff, that's a whole different ballgame again. But mixing and mastering, I feel like if I watched this YouTube thing from someone, I can't remember who it was, in the mix or something. I still do that, you know. I love watching all these tutorials as well, as you know. I know how to compress a snare drum, but I still like to see how other people do it. So I watch these tutorials, and this one guy said, there's this phrase going around in you know, in the mixing and mastering world, you can't polish a turd, you know. And that's really what it is. If your track is really crappy sounding, you can't master, you know, the living shit out of it, but it will never sound amazing. So it all starts with getting a decent mix, at least a decent sounding mix that is, you know, is already somewhat ready to play out in a way. And the mastering can just do that final sort of, the final bit, the final 10%, let's say, to make it sound punchy and loud. So, but yeah, I mean, I would definitely love to spend more time on learning how to really play. Yeah.
And Callum Roberts is asking, any pointers on how to approach writing a top line or counter melody to complement the main melody in terms of songwriting? I mean, it's nice to hear that you're not, wouldn't consider yourself a player, because I think a lot of music producers maybe don't come from that background. So it's great to have someone who doesn't consider themselves a player, but obviously can write very beautiful music.
Well, I think if you're not live on stage, it's not really something you really need. Although I do find myself sometimes limited by not having that exact knowledge. You know, if I talk to some friends of mine who can play really well, they just sit down and have a whole conversation with me while they're playing, you know. And if I'm looking for a chord, for such and such a chord, they say, oh, you can do it like this, this. They put down, you know, so many different ways of doing the same chord with all inversions and all kinds of stuff, which is, you know, amazing. And I, you know, I can do it, but I need my time in the studio to just, you know, program it more. So, but yeah, top line. One thing that I always keep in mind with a top line is to make it really simple to sing along to. And coming from the days of vinyl and going out clubbing and, you know, hearing a DJ play a track in a club and you think like, wow, what's this? And you go to the booth and you see that the guy has a sticker on his vinyl so you can read the title. That's what they did back in the day. Damn it. You know, so you have to remember that melody, and the next day you want to go to the record store and say to the guy behind the counter that you are looking for the track that goes. And if it's a really complicated melody or it has no real hook as a melody, it's really hard to explain what you're looking for. So having said that, right now it's not anymore 20 years ago with vinyl, we're today. But in my head, it still applies to today, you know. It's, you want to recognize it straight away, and an easy to sing melody that has symmetry to it, that has a start, and you at the end of the melody you feel like you almost want to fall into the start of the melody again. That's how I always approach melodies, you know. And I get a lot of demos in for the label that are beautifully produced trance tracks, but the melody just goes all over the place, and it's really hard to follow where this track is actually trying to take you. So that would definitely be my advice, you know, simplicity is key.
Yeah, that's great advice. Matthias is asking, do you use templates for your arpeggiator notes, or do you have different quick way of getting there? Like, do you have any kind of melody style plugins? Sometimes you get those MIDI that generate MIDI notes in certain keys. Do you use any of those types of tools?
No, I always, like what I said earlier, you know, I start here with the chords, and I go from there. So because I very often let my arpeggiator follow the chord progression. So I use my chord MIDI to build an arpeggiator. And once you start with that, it's easy to fill in just the same sort of rhythmic pattern of the notes. To get, look, if I put the two together, hang on a minute, maybe I should just do this one octave down, then you can see what I mean. Look, pretty much it's following the chords, right? So here it is, these are probably a bass note is up there. Wait, where is it? No, it's not. Anyway, well, this, see, I could use these notes here as well, you know, on this key in the chord, but it does sound better. So it's a good starting point is your chords, and then listen, and perhaps you start hearing certain notes in the arpeggiator that don't really work or are blending in to the rest too much. So, but yeah, starting with the chords is easiest.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, Shah Woodley Mitchell is asking if you have any tips on breaking away from the classic 16-bar loop. We've all been there before, getting stuck in the 16-bar loop. Any advice on structure would be welcome.
Any advice on structure? I mean, a 16-bar loop or 8-bar loop, sure, that's all the same. I've had melodies where it's almost like 4 bars would have done it, but I needed 2 extra, so they became 6-bar. And I think my track "Rock Your Body Rock" is a good example of that. It's just that extra end of a part at the end is what makes the melody so much more interesting. And I feel like we are sometimes too hung up on, you know, 4, 8. 16/32s, whatever, within that sort of divide, you know, way of dividing it, because most tracks are built like that. And for a DJ, it's really annoying if you start with at a new bar almost, and your next bar in this track starts after 8 bars, and then the other track is actually a 6-bar track before it starts again, before the bar starts again, right? So your mixes are not aligned, or your tracks are not aligned. So therefore you can get really creative in making tracks that have a 6-bar melody, for example, but always have like a good sort of in and out that is 8 bars. My remix of Barbara Sadaja for Strings is a really good example that has like a crazy number of bars that is not even lined up with anything, but at the end, you know, I reset it basically by going to an 8-bar section again. So I hope that answers your question a bit, but never be limited. You know, if you feel that your melody should have a little more than 4 bars, just do it, but make sure you just reset it at the beginning and the end.
Yeah, for all the DJs out there.
Yeah.
We got time for maybe a couple more questions before we move on to the next section. Giles McDonald says, love the album, ambient album. Has the lockdown given you a chance to finish this year's Goyala track? And if so, when will it be out?
Yeah. Well, you can't really see it here right now, but if I do this, hang on a minute. I don't want to see you. See, the screen is on. Oh, you can really see it. Over there. Over there. That is actually the next Goyala track. So it's funny you ask, but
World exclusive insight there.
It is, yeah. I mean, you know, a sketch as is this, you know, it starts there. But I have a melody that I'm very happy about, and the chords. So now it's time to fill in the rest of the production. But working on it as we speak, yes.
We've got a few questions about that particular track, actually. Some people are asking, how did you get that signature sound within that record?
In Goyala or in this one?
In Goyala, yes.
In Goyala. I guess all the Goyala tracks, I think that's probably a rule that I have for myself. You know, all the Goyala tracks need to have this melancholy, this sadness, yet hopeful sort of vibe and emotion. Yeah, and it's just, you know, when the synth comes in, I don't want it to be just a synth. I want it to be a blanket. And, you know, therefore, using a lot of reverb, obviously, and delay will really do that. I love playing around with delays because you can have, like, you can program something with a certain rhythm. But if you use, like, a 3/4 delay or something, you know, it starts filling in the little spaces where you did not put your notes. So it starts building another sort of rhythmic blanket around what you did. And especially if you start offsetting your left and right delays a little timing wise, it starts to clash almost, but it really gives this nice sort of, it's like I said, a blanket of sound. But the most important thing is this sort of sad and hopeful feeling at the same time in one track. So you don't know if you should feel sad or happy, and that's always what I'm looking for with Goyala.
Yeah, I mean that kind of ties into the next question actually. Well, Anuka asks, when it comes to effects for your melodies, do you insert or mostly send them out to the effects rack? And what kind of effects do you use on melodies?
Right. Yeah, it really depends on what I'm going to do with it. Usually I like to use them as an insert. Just because I don't know, it's just easy. But sometimes I want to, for example, I want to really sidechain my, let's say a reverb. If I have that on my insert, it's not possible, right? So I need to use it on a send and then use a separate sidechaining to sidechain the reverb. Also, if you want to go a little more in depth on your EQing on your reverb or delay or whatever you want to do, or sometimes you have, sometimes you want to use a distortion effect, but the distortion doesn't have a mix, you know. So you put it on a send and then mix your send return, you know, slightly in, so you create a mix. So. What am I using? Like I said, I use a lot of delays, a lot of reverb. Sometimes even on my bass notes, it's very strange, but I kind of often use a room effect as well, which I then pre-delay. So it's almost like a room reverb that I pre-delay to become almost like a slapback delay, but it's the reverb, and it gives the bass sound and an extra sort of dimension rather than it being dry. That's something I play a lot with. And like I said earlier, I love offsetting stuff. And there's some amazing plugins out right now. For example, Portal and Remnant that have these crazy sort of warp delay type of effects with reverse modes in it as well. So you have this sort of like within your delay, you have like zip, 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 these crazy reverb effects coming in. So yeah, that's what I use a lot.
Nice one. So we got one more question here from Randy, and it kind of leads into the next part. So perfect. Yes, cool. When can we hear the finished product of what you're working on?
Ah, that leads us into the next part, for sure. It's like we set it all up to have these questions like this, huh? Yeah. Anyway, okay, yeah, that's a good one. So what am I working on right now? This is not something I'm working on. This can potentially be something that we are all working on. You know, for the guys out there, girls as well, who have been following me, especially noticed over the last few years that I've done a lot of collaborations under the Unity banner. And previously, I've always been working with other DJs, Paulo Gefold, Elon Bluestone, BT, you know, name them, Cameron Dresden, and a bunch of other guys. And I felt like, hey, you know, it's cool. There's a new Unity coming up. More news about that soon. But after that, I want another Unity release. And what better time to get united in a way than now, since we're all sitting at home. And I know out there, hopefully watching right now, are a lot of aspiring producers or hobby producers or even producers out there, you know, like myself, that are touring the world and whatever, and find it interesting and fun to just get together for this project. So I wanna ask you to participate in this new project under the Unity banner, where I basically supply the MIDI that you see in this live chat, the presets of this live chat, and also what you heard as it like in audio. So I did it in audio, just with and without, as you can see here. See, that's not a good example. Here is that melody, completely dry. Here with reverb. Same for the synths. Right. So these will all be available for download and for you to actually start creating your part in this story with. I don't expect you to build a full track, but what I would love from you is if you feel inspired to create a bass line that is not here yet, or you feel inspired to change the chords or the sound of the chords, or add certain notes to the melody, go ahead. This is a kickstart. This is just what I give everyone to get creative with, have fun with. And then once you submit all your parts, I will start creating a track out of the parts that I've received, out of the best ones, to come up with a final Unity track. So this is going to be Unity on steroids, where it's not between me and a DJ, but it's between me and you guys. We're all in this together, literally. And yeah, let's come up with the next trance banger and have some fun. So that's basically what I would like to ask you. All the details, you will be supplying that, Declan, on your website, I guess. So
yes, we'll be giving people information about how to do it.
And of course, they will also be on my social media, where to download it, and all the submission details for when you send your stuff over. And I'm just really excited to just go with go have some fun with you guys. Again, I can't stress it enough that this is just something to kick off with. I mean, we gotta start somewhere. It's not really set in stone that it has to be this, but let's start with this and see what comes back. The only thing that I really want to stress out to everyone who's going to participate is to stay within key and stay within BPM. It's 134 BPM. Why? Trance is between 130 and 138. And I decided to just go for one in the middle that everyone can play. But if someone submits parts that are in 140 BPM and someone else in 128, it doesn't really work for the track to work together. We can stretch it, whatever, of course, but it won't really help the quality. So let's stay within 134 BPM in the key of C, and go from here. That's the only, those are the only rules.
Nice one. So great opportunity to get some stems directly from Ferry's hard drive. And you'll be able to have a listen to how you can hear them dry and wet, like you said. So it's not only just a bit of fun, but it's a way you can hear some insight into how you actually produce, right?
Yeah, there's the MIDI, there's the and the presets. So you can actually load the MIDI into your system. And, you know, and if you have silent or if you have pigments, you can just come up with, you know, import the preset that I sent as well. So you hear exactly what's happening there. And then you have the dry audio and you have the wet audio with like reverb and delay. So it's all sorts of layers where you can really hear what's going on and actually take the MIDI with the preset or your own preset and start playing around and you know, create a melody based of what I just gave you guys. And let's go from there.
Nice one. All right, very well. We are out of time for today, so thanks for joining us. And of course, if you want to enter that competition, you will get all the details on Ferry socials of where to grab those stems from. So thanks for your time today, mate.
Stay safe. Same here, man. Thanks everyone for showing support and for following us here. So stay safe, guys.
See you later.
Bye now.
So that was, of course, Ferry Corsten's very special insight into how he makes trance melodies and a great competition as well. You can grab all the information across his socials. And we'll be back next week once again with another stream. We'll be back with Rebecca. It's getting insight into how she makes her music. So we'll see you next week. See ya.